structure, people aren't forced to stay around and be whenever they want to leave. So the question is, if you flex a lift and you design this type of environment, how do we attract and engage in personalities? How do we draw people in from what are they think, like the level of usability? So we're just trying to figure out how this thing works. Resources, environmental resources, so resources like a cognitive level, physical level, stress level, and whatnot. So these are the types of questions that I'm going to wrestle with. Make sense so far? So here's the thesis of what I'm going to try to convince you or argue with is that casual interaction and also intentional interaction. Casual interaction gives designers opportunities to shape objects and situations to evoke cultural forms of service and learning. And obviously, learning about different forms of what they're going to have to play about. Right? So, casual interaction gives designers these opportunities to evoke cultural forms. That, in turn, helps to shape social interaction that takes place in our lives. We do it with it, the learning experience at any time. And it helps activate these kinds of resources that are interested in help make documents experience support for them. So the idea is we're trying to sort of add structure that participants bring into the activity themselves. So we're not closing that structure from so, briefly, right, tangible interaction. So, the idea is this term tangible actually came out of research at the MIT Media Lab originally in the 90s, early 2000s. Where Moshibishi was coined the term originally. It was influenced by people like Resnick, where there's been a long history of people who influenced that in terms of this whole ubiquitous computing vision that came out of the arts part a decade earlier from people like Thompson Brown, Mark Weiser. And I think, in large part, what's sort of tangible, and it's sort of about if people really got into this idea of tangible interaction in part, it's this idea that much of the richness of human interaction with the physical world through the use of tools has been kind of abandoned, supplanted by what the Stanford paper calls moving pictures on your glass. Okay, so much of like our human exclusivity has been replaced by this thing that our head through moving pictures on glass. But if you think about any designer out painter, those are the ones. Have all of these tools, all the brushes, the palette knives, the canvases, the paints, the smells, the textures, they go along with creative paintings. And they have parts of the array of tools that a carpenter might use on any particular job. If you think about the last time you prepared a meal at home, and all of the tools that you used to prepare that meal and how rich, hopefully, your stuff is in order to meal experience was for them, you think you forbid it. It was terrible. So, this idea that we can preserve the advantages of digital interaction but bring some of the services back into it. Okay, so it's kind of like humanizing and taking control of the interaction problem. Does that sort of make sense? So, one of the definitions of tangibles is this idea that you take physical objects and object is a token. The token stands for digital information or stands for operation on digital information. A later definition from people into what the earthquake has measured from that point in the classroom. And then you do this on triangulation where you're going to put the deficit of the earthquake over here, put 10 down on the floor, and forward, creates a fault line kind of emerges as this line of students coming across the floor of the classroom. So these are just screens, but just two data screens. But the difference between me going to a screen and getting an activity on my computer, some sort of macro world or some sort of learning environment, right? This is the learning environment, this is the classroom. I'm just used as a screen to create, create this design social experience that fits within the classroom and interactions with students that I'm. So that's what I would consider an example of screen. Paul Durrance calls this embodied interactions. He also calls it people from hearing, but he seems like that, but it's completely interrelated. Objects carry meaning on multiple levels and stations in their own right. The signifiers of social meaning, these elements and systems of practice. But those three ones are kind of. So there have been many, many, many tangible learning designs that people have created, researchers in particular. It's kind of misused. I think that people who are interested in learning are sort of immediately drawn to this idea of tangibles. But I think that's a good reason. There's this kind of, the community has struggled to find kind of a solid theoretical and empirical foundation for why tangible interaction should be better than any other type of learning. Some of the other things are like, TSA systems are more concrete, things are great, and therefore tangibles are awesome. And that's, a characterization that's not too far off from a lot of the other papers that sort of talk about tangible interactions. One sort of theoretical direction that's gaining a lot of traction in the tangible community that they're building off of ideas of embodied cognition. So the basic argument, and in fact, the tangible community is kind of not found to be part of the Leighton Johnson formulation of this. So the basic argument goes like, embodying sensory motor experiences with the physical world, starting in infancy, form a kind of metaphorical foundation through which we understand a whole variety of abstract concepts. Okay? And this is kind of the way that the argument is taken up. And this is really appealing to people in tangibles because you can say, okay, well, we can use tangible interaction to kind of design more intuitive mappings between abstract concepts and the ways as diverse as music or math or whatever it is. And actions with our bodies, manipulations of physical objects, and even like the texture, shape, depth, and sort of physical properties. So what I want to do is, I'm going to push back on this direction The first is that because it's embodied cognition in particular, you need to place an emphasis on cognition to the extent that there's some kinds of wrong things knowledge all the way up to, that interpretation can shift activity. And so when we're ignoring that, we're not being pushed. I think we're missing out on a huge potential of people. And I think also like, it means that designers are sort of failing to critique the cultural nature of our own designs. Okay. I want you to imagine that we're in a room and there's some elementary kids in the room. And it doesn't matter how old they are, whatever, there's some kids in the room. And they start to walk into the room. This is an object on the table and it walks away. Okay, so this is the object. So the question is what happens next? Just about the opposite. And the other problem is that you can do that probably about this becomes a strong and recognizable cultural form. That then teases these patterns of social interaction and all these kind of cool resources where I know how to go. I know how to sing songs, and how do I, you know, play with my friends. And so by putting the patterns on this, we can impose structure on the activity, but the structure was there. administrative resources on the part of the individual to know and have known about the game and how to do some sort of way of anticipating what I'm going to do and what I'm going to do. If you know something about me, you're trying to like person change my thought process. There's all sorts of things that go into that process. It's just kind of plays out. Not only the concept of the is the things we watch from the table. And the passion we subscribe to, like everyone. And even if I'm a little brother, I think it's such a different thing, I can just hold on to it a little while. And like, that helps me feel a little bit more invested in the activity. And I'm just a little weapon for a lot. And I'm like, I still like have a hand on the activity. But the other thing we saw, which is kind of interesting, is how likely people were to try things at the time of day. And so, for example, like adult men, black bars are the graphical condition, and gray bars are the tangibles. So, adult men are sort of the most likely to try the tangible therapy. But for every other group that we looked at, from the gay girls, boys, and men, people were significantly more likely to try things at this. So for example, girls, you get about a third of girls are trapping to try these things, and there's some mouse on the table, and that goes up to something like 85% of girls are trapping to try these things. This is before the age of digital touch screens, really, so this is, you can imagine what the mouse is about. The 99 is a little bit small on these, so you don't have to use some of the very small, but that's the data that we have from this. So the question for me is, like, what's going on? You see, it's kind of like, you know, we go there and do tests and fits, and then, like, midway through the interview, we switch out to the next one. So we ask them some questions, we ask them to do some things, and then we swap out. But you see things like, you know, a girl with 600 grams of lab, and you add the kind of words in the mouse, and then we dump the big box on the table, and, like, the girl, you know, pops off her head, and starts putting the box together and stuff. We did see the kind of qualitative shifts where it seemed like we're getting more of a child to women kind of experience with the box than with the mouse. So the question is for me, like, what's going on here? Like, why are people more likely to try with the box? Okay. I'm not worried it's not the effect of the mouse, but it's like a new way of programming, so that's kind of cool. I want to try that. Except that we're in a great science museum, all sorts of tangible things have led us on. I'm a little skeptical of that explanation. The explanation that seems to make more sense to me is like, when you have to say, blocks are more, it's kind of like they just seem more, you know, fun. And so the question for me then, like, well, why does the blocks seem more child friendly? Why is it that they seem more fun? Or are they more funny? What I want to propose is that, like, the wood blocks of this kind of strong cultural form, people do come up and be like, look at the wood blocks, and you turn their culture into things like toys, basic shit, like play with. And that in turn sort of changes the type of participation and the type of people. And if you're almost like doing this quick calculus, like I'm looking at a monogram, I can do that, I can do that, I can do that. And I'm trying to start kind of John Paul Kass is the intense identity for people in museums, so you come to a museum and it's like providing at this institution on the stage. And so I think that there's something going on with some sort of a micro identity kind of process going on. Maybe. So the question is, like, you guys said, well, these, why doesn't this look like a cultural form like the JSON puzzle, right? Like the wood blocks, maybe they look like JSON puzzle pieces, that's great, but these also look like JSON puzzle pieces. So they should have the same sort of. So my argument here is that last day, we got this thing and say that we have completion in the activity from where you brought it, that you're connected. And the activity itself is more interesting. And in fact, there's a lot of years around the screen, so if you think that many classrooms, but 10 people would go to the right. So it doesn't say how to get it, then it's just something that's the next day. So, but when I look for different things, I'm like, okay, especially how, like the time is a club and it's so exciting, it just dances against us and dances across everything. So that's why you just dance to that neighborhood and go to the dance three times. And then this one is like, this is the awareness to wait for a while and just tap on them. So you just tap on the screen and then do that again. And what happens is in this, where the sword goes, you get sheets of stickers, and so they're just like, it's like a blue box, and they're like, they're being able to fly there, and then put out your ears and actions and that kind of thing. So if you can get these stickers off, the stickers are just a blue box. usually step by the cultural form and rather be interpreted differently. It's not a way of playing the fire. You've got to give up on this whole idea that it's kind of a universal kind of learning environment. And that inviting the resistance into this actually kind of cool and sort of culture. So we're out of time, so I'm going to leave it at that. I've got a lot of this stuff to talk about. Thank you. exactly the expectations of every student in the current time. So, and it's not around the ball, and how they use the ball.
Thank you.